For this second video on the Arrhenius equation, we will describe the second variation of this equation that we use. This equation is also on your equation sheet. So there are two purposes for using this one. We can solve for the rate constant after we make a change in temperature, or we can solve for the activation energy if we know rate constants and temperatures. The key for this equation is that, or the key to using this equation is to recognize that it works for two sets of data points. Notice in our equation down here, we have temperatures labeled 1 and 2. We also have rate constants labeled 1 and 2. A couple of key notes before we get into a sample calculation and setup. First of all, remember our temperature must be in Kelvin, and that is to help cancel the units of Kelvin in our R. So if we're given Celsius, we need to convert that into Kelvin by adding the 273.15. We also need to pay attention to the units that we're working with. So activation energy is commonly in kilojoules per mole. Our R constant, however, is in units of joules per mole per Kelvin. And so we have to make sure whatever values we're given, make sure that those will be in the same so that they can cancel out. The last thing to watch for is to make sure that as you're plugging in values, whatever is given as your rate constant at a given temperature needs to be matched up. And then if you're given rate constant at a changing temperature, make sure that those match. And it technically doesn't matter which one you assign as 1 or 2, as long as the rate constant goes with its corresponding temperature. And so the practice calculation that we'll work or start the setup for, I'll have you finish the math of it, but we'll start the setup, is this first one. And then the second one that's listed on this slide has a practice with the answer for you to check yourself. So on this blank slide here, I have our same question. We're going to use the activation energy that we calculated previously from our graph example. So notice this is the unrounded value of our activation energy. Good practice is always to use unrounded values in successive calculations, just so we don't get a rounding error. And a note, we're using the same equation we had before. And so our question here is to calculate the rate constant at a new temperature if we're given an initial rate constant and initial temperature. And so again, we are going to write our equation. Notice in this one, the activation energy divided by R does not have a negative in front of it. You might see variations of this equation. There are multiple variations that exist that are equally valid, where you might have a negative here for the slope, or in front of the activation energy over R, but it ends up reversing our temperature quantities. So again, there are other variations of this equation that exist out there. They are equivalent. So if you use them and set it up right, you will get the right answer. All right, so we have this equation, and now we want to track what goes where. So again, we're trying to find a new rate constant. So for K1, we are given the value of 3.52 times 10 to the minus 7, m negative 1 times s negative 1. Our unknown is the K2 value. Now my activation energy, notice, is in kilojoules. So I'm going to go ahead and convert that back to joules per mole, so that when I divide by my R constant that is also in joules, those units will cancel out. For my temperatures, for these, as you're calculating, make sure you're paying attention to order of operations. And so again, remember, if we're solving for K2, that means that my new temperature, this 325 degrees Celsius, is going to be my T2. And that means that I need to convert that into Kelvin. And so that becomes a 598. I'm using the 0.15 for the conversion. And then I subtract from that my initial temperature at 555 Kelvin. So a couple of notes. Again, I'm going to ask you to calculate through this, but this is our setup. One note is a prediction. So we have gone from, this is our T1, our initial temperature. This is our T2. Notice our temperature has increased, and that means we expect our K2 value to also increase. So our final answer should be larger than our initial value of K1. The second thing to pay attention to is order of operations, specifically for this temperature component. So in your calculator, because we have division here to make sure you have the right order of operations, I always recommend putting that inverse of temperature in parentheses, then subtracting those two values, and then just watching your order of operations. Again, at the end, you're going to have to get rid of your ln in order to solve for K2. So you're going to eventually need to take the inverse operation of that and raise both sides to the E. In the slides, I have left the full solution. So I again encourage you to practice through this, go through the calculations and the steps so that you can follow through and make sure that you are getting this final answer. And again, notice that is larger than K1, so the answer makes sense. Going back to our practice slide then, I also recommend practicing with this equation. Notice here you're calculating for an activation energy. So work with these practice variations, these equations for the Arrhenius energy.